10 past 10. Most of the children are probably in bed, but these boys are fucking mentality giants. It's unbelievable. It's unbelievable.
Sorry about the language.
If I have to find me if you want. I'm not native, so I don't have better words for it. It's unbelievable.
Hello and welcome to a bonus episode of the Corner Flag, because we have to discuss a match that completely blew our minds. Man City versus Leicester. Let's talk about how Leicester almost took Man City out. 1-0 victory. 1-0 victory.
We don't know what FC Zurich, FC Boston, Kazan.
Fucking around. Mukesh, this is your moment. Liverpool 4-0 Barcelona at Anfield. Through to the finals, through to Madrid 19.
You know, I feel like this season needed a moment of catharsis for every Liverpool fan, and this was it. Because just last night, we got a big kick in the mouth because of the fact that Leicester didn't beat Man City and Man City didn't lose points, and credit to them. But we needed one big moment and we're like, what do we do? And we turned it around against the greatest club ever.
Right.
And after having been written off after the first leg to come back 4-0, Amok, there are a few matches which where you look back and be like, where were you during that match?
Right.
For the generation slightly before me, it was Istanbul.
Yeah.
This is that match for me. For my generation.
I don't blame you. Honestly, I hate Liverpool as much as any United loving fan in the world.
I do know that.
But
you've made it clear.
Yeah, but this was something completely, like, this was a fairy tale. Like, completely, having supported a team that has two comebacks to its name in the Champions League, you know, Bayern Munich in 99 and PSG earlier
really?
This year.
That's what we're going to do? Is that how
I understand what you're feeling. I understand the elation. By the way, like, Mukesh called me in the middle of the night as soon as the game was done, palpitating, to say, we have to do a bonus episode. We have to do an episode. I have to talk about this. And,
and I was eating mangoes at the time. That's how I celebrated.
No, I love it. I love it. It's great. For the listeners, if you want to know what Mukesh's sex face sounds like, listening to the duration of this podcast, you will know exactly that is.
Yeah, you wait, because I don't know if you guys caught, there's something pretty epic happened last night in the world of football. So just want to sum it down for those listeners who don't know. Liverpool and Barca played in the semi-final of the Champions League. In the first leg, Liverpool went to Camp Nou. I've learned how to pronounce it. Liverpool went to Camp Nou and they lost 3-0. And I said before that they lost to Messi's greatness, because he provided one great and stunning free kick that buried the game, and Liverpool failed to score because they didn't capitalize on the chances. And everybody wrote Liverpool off because they had a title race, they didn't have enough rest, and we lost Firmino, we lost Salah. And coming to second leg, the only solace and the only thing working in Liverpool's favour was that it was at Anfield. And then Liverpool went and fucking did
it. There is something magical about Anfield, isn't
there? That place is something else.
I mean, okay. Again,
here's what I have to say. In the first leg, Liverpool lost to Messi. In the second leg, Barca lost to Anfield.
We made a few predictions, right? Like, in the last couple of episodes, we made a few predictions.
Yeah.
I just want to play them
and
out right now.
I was the pessimistic one and you had more hope in Liverpool.
Probably. Let's find out.
As much as neutral as you can be, do you think Liverpool can pull off a victory?
I think so.
No, it looks like...
I think so. I think Liverpool can pull off a victory, but in one leg.
Amok, you got that right.
I got that right. Spot on.
Clearly never been objective about Liverpool. You got that about Liverpool.
Hey, fair play, man. Good football, good teams, strong teams.
The best team.
Not the best team.
I feel like it's the best team. It doesn't have the best players, but it has the best team.
Fair. It's fair. Would you say Liverpool's always had that?
Yeah.
Because no matter how shitty certain generations of players have been for Liverpool, there's always been a certain storyline about the club being, you know, with the support and with the
being
noise.
More than a sum of its parts.
Yeah, with the noise that Anfield makes and with the cop end and, you know, all the legendary stuff that is associated with Liverpool, about how intimidating that club is or that ground is.
And I think it's especially in the Klopp era, what happens is, say what you want about Klopp's tactics, you know for a fact that his players are giving 100%.
Right.
They might not work.
Right.
They might be extremely comical. They might look absolutely shite sometimes. Right. But
surely Dejan Lovren is giving 65%.
No, I feel like the problem is that's Dejan's 100%.
Okay.
Dejan's 100% comes with him doing stupid stuff, and that's the scary part.
Right.
So either way, which means that the crowd, and there's no, I don't think no crowd in England loves it more than Anfield.
Right.
When just seeing players give 100%.
Yeah.
And they did it. And they were the 12th and the 13th man. everybody turned up. Everybody, even small things, like there's a little anecdote about how apparently the previous night when Barcelona arrived outside the Barcelona hotel in the Hilton, apparently Liverpool fans were bursting firecrackers outside the hotel just so that they wouldn't get sleep. That's how committed they were. And there was this weird rumor about Barcelona bus going missing. Like when they'd come, some Liverpool fan had stolen the Barcelona bus and were taken down the city. So I think the match began before the whistle.
I think the celebrations began before the whistle. But after the first leg defeat at the Camp Nou, you were a little distraught and you said something a couple of episodes ago that really stuck by us. We'll just refresh our memories with that.
I would have loved it in the future where if Messi said, you know what, this was the game or this is the team that troubled me a little bit. Mm. But I felt like he just swatted Liverpool away. Like, we could have been get away or Celta Vigo. Yeah. Like, he won't even remember this match. Yeah, he's going to remember this match for the rest of his life.
Yeah.
He's going to, you know, this is, have you seen Dark Knight Returns? The comic movie?
No.
So this is iconic scene in that where Batman has defeated Superman.
Okay.
Right? And then, and that's the whole man defeating God, right? That's
right,
the idea.
Right.
And then he holds Superman up and Superman's aging and clearly defeated.
Right.
And Batman holds him up and says, in your most private moments, remember this. Remember the person who defeated you. Okay, and then he lets him go. And I feel like this is the closest I've ever seen to a real life version of it.
Right.
Because Messi is definitely going to remember this.
Yeah.
In his nightmares, it's going to be red. And it's going to be ringing. You'll never walk alone. Yeah. Among it's great. It was the greatest match ever.
I mean, Messi might remember this, but somebody forgot Messi because there was a random report doing the rounds, and I don't know how true this is or if we can verify it. But apparently, there's some Spanish newspaper that put out a report saying, as soon as the game at Anfield was done, all the Barcelona players were so distraught they just got into the bus. And they left immediately for the airport. Except they forgot that Messi was hanging out with fans. They forgot arguably the best player in the world. That guy is worth
millions. That's reflecting the behavior on the pitch.
And it's like they've forgotten an invaluable asset. Like insurance companies would have lost their shit. Tum log pagal ho gaya.
No, but I think actually Messi just said, fuck it, I can't do with this team anymore.
Yeah.
Because let's talk about other players. Let's talk about other Barca players.
Yeah, let's actually talk about the game. We've only spoken about the East
Coast. So first, let's get this out of the way. Fuck off Suarez. I think Liverpool's love affair with Suarez.
That's going to be the title of this episode, I think.
Done. Fuck off Suarez. It's done. Yeah. Because Liverpool's...
As a United fan, I'm completely on board with that.
I think you guys were right.
Yeah.
This is how we bought.
Yeah.
but because I think Liverpool's love affair with him is completely over.
Right.
The minute he celebrated, it was done.
Yeah.
And then he came back and he fouled Andy Robertson.
Yeah.
Right? And that was absolutely disgusting.
He's
going
to miss a few games. Robertson.
There are only two games left. Well, I think it looks...
Let me rephrase that. He's going to miss a couple of games.
I don't think definitely not the final. Because not when in the final, I can say. Liverpool's not going to miss. He's not going to miss the final.
Robertson will want to play.
Yeah, he wants to play.
Wants to
but
play.
I think he might miss the Wolves game, but let's see. The other thing was the crowd, the minute he got the ball, started chanting, fuck off Suarez. Especially, I think, when Fabinho got a yellow card early on because of a foul. It looked like a rash tackle, but he got the ball.
Right.
He got the ball. It was a clean tackle. Mm. And then you could see this pitch where Suarez did his classic theatrics and he's lying on the ground. It's stuff that stirred Anfield in the past, but I think now Anfield gave him what it feels like to not be loved at Anfield.
Yeah.
He got loved now. He got the hate at Anfield.
Yeah.
Because then you can see Fabinho.
The complete footballing experience.
Yeah. Then you can just see Fabinho barking at him. I think there's an image of it that's gone popular also.
Right.
And that is basically, and at that point began the fuck off Suarez chant.
Right.
Which, and that was it. That was the end. Coutinho went completely missing. So that's, I think nobody really cared.
Yeah.
They booed us before he got the ball. But the vitriol against Suarez was real. It was nice. It was felt because Suarez looked like he felt pain.
Yeah.
Like the theatrics rile him on.
Yeah.
But I think that was the moment where he's like...
At some point also, didn't Andy Robertson ruffle Messi's hair or something?
Yep. Oh, that was the greatest moment I've seen. Because let me tell you about Andy Robertson. This kid 5-6 years back was working in a supermarket playing for Queen's Park Rangers and saying shit like, I wish I had more money.
Yeah.
Right? And by then, Messi had become an international superstar. And now look at him, he's back and he's ruffling Messi's hair, knowing that that's the one thing that pisses Messi off the most from what his opponents can do. Right? I mean, it's the audacity. I think for me, it's the audacity to believe and the audacity to get away with that sort of shit. From a young 20-year-old Scotsman who's doing that to probably the greatest player of not just his generation, of all generations, of all sports.
Yeah. And I'm going to focus on Messi for a bit. You're saying that's one of the only things that pisses him off. Like, how zen do you have to be? Like, this is like Buddha level zen shit. You know, like, nothing in the world can piss me off. But if you touch my hair.
And also think about it, right? People are scared to be around Messi. This guy went and ruffled his hair. Amok, would you ruffle God's hair if you saw him?
I wouldn't, because there is no God.
If God existed, would you ruffle his hair? Well, Andy Robertson would do it. He's got a hell.
It'll be really weird if I go to Sachin Tendulkar and ruffle his hair. So it'll just be really creepy.
Yeah, okay. Imagine you're playing. And that's what he did. So that was fantastic.
If I'm drunk enough, I might just.
And Andy Robertson did not have to be drunk. He just had to play.
He's Scottish. I don't think that. I think that's default. He did not need to be drunk. He just needed to be Scottish, which he is. And I guess that just works. I think Andy Robertson, instead of protein shakes, just has like three pints of beer
and then just gets. But he had a fantastic game in the first half. He kept.
He's a good defender.
And I think. I don't know if this is on a photo that became popular. He said Messi was surrounded by 5 Liverpool players.
Yeah.
It was the three or the two fullbacks, Matip and Van Dijk. Then you had Robertson and you had Fabinho and Henderson.
Yeah.
5 people just caging in on Messi, making sure Messi had nowhere to go.
Yeah.
And I think that was basically the plan. And they realized that if Messi doesn't give you the distribution, you cut
the main.
There's no moment of inspiration coming from Suarez or.
They don't have Iniesta or Xavi anymore to kind of.
And in that first 7 minutes,
to carry Messi as all the memes go. There's that great photo. You've seen that great photo of Messi at a nightclub getting drunk and he's assisted by Xavi and Iniesta. Even at a nightclub, Messi needs.
Because what happened in the previous leg was Jordi Alba kept coming in front because he had that confidence. But his mistake led to the first goal.
Yeah.
Brilliant move from Mane. We'll get to that in a bit.
Yeah.
So that means Jordi Alba, because he made that mistake, he saw the goals were coming, the runs were coming, he stayed back.
Yeah.
Which means there was nobody to feed Suarez anything. So, and Coutinho is obviously having a shit time.
Yeah.
In fact, it looks like he's going to be sold first thing. Like, if they could sell him now, they would sell him. If they could leave him behind at Liverpool, they would leave him behind.
Yeah. PSG, there's another player coming your way.
Yeah.
This is the house of rejects.
Barca rejects.
All team rejects, honestly, not just Barca. I mean, I'm hoping even Alexis finds his way over there. It'd be great.
That'd be nice.
Yeah.
So that was a great team move, and Messi really looked rattled. I think because between Fabinho and Van Dijk and Matip, they formed that triangle that just didn't give them that central space.
Yeah.
And then that gets to the next player I really want to talk about, which is Alisson. What a sensational Champions League he's having, because he did it last year with Roma.
He had a bunch of great saves. That's exactly the type of defense goalkeeping unit that you need, right? Like, your defense is already tight. It's a very strong defense. But on the off chance that it leaks a bit,
you have
one of the best last men in the league.
Yeah, and again, I think something that might go unnoticed is because those saves necessarily don't look sexy. They don't look like a goalkeeper diving across the goalpost, pushing away with one hand. Yeah. But those are really tough shots to save. Those ones when Messi and Suarez come from the sides and then try to sneak it in. Those are extremely, incredibly tough shots that don't look sexy enough for the camera. So we might not appreciate them enough.
Yeah. I want to talk about Wijnaldum as well. Like, if we can move on.
I think we'll go slowly. We'll go first the goalkeeper, then the defense, then the midfield, and then the goals.
Yeah, we don't have time for this. It's still a bonus episode. It's not a full length episode.
Okay, cool.
Very quickly, I want to talk about Wijnaldum, because great substitution by Klopp. Half-time substitution.
Thanks to Suarez.
Thanks.
Completely thanks to Suarez.
Hey, in his heart of hearts, there still beats.
And there was good reason to not play him, because Klopp played him in an attacking position
last leg.
And it didn't pay off as well. And Klopp got criticized for it, because they were like, why wouldn't you play your other players? They were Sturridge. Why would not play him, you know?
Because Sturridge has been shit throughout the season.
I don't get
fans who question the manager's tactics like this. Like, this is such an obvious thing to do. Like,
exactly. And it didn't pay off for one hand.
If your options are Daniel Sturridge and a table fan, go for the table fan. I learned that on Football Manager 2019.
Hey, that's a little harsh. I'm sorry. Sorry, Sturridge.
It's not. As a Liverpool fan, are you seriously telling
me? No, I'm not. But I'm just saying.
Exactly. You're just feeling extra happy and extra lovable towards all of the players that you're scoring.
I love Moreno right now. I'll go ruffle Moreno there.
Oh.
So
why not Aldum, right? Like, that was a great, great substitution. And it wasn't a like-for-like substitution. It was a substitution where Andy Robertson came off because of the injury.
And that meant two things. That meant Milner is the one playing on left back. And that's where Messi plays. And Milner and Messi have history.
Right?
Right.
And, Milner's so old, he probably has history with Pele.
Pele.
Unnecessary dig, I'm sorry.
So he has that. And the last, like, just Milner pushed Messi away. So, like, there's immediate history too. And I think Milner did it. Milner did a good job and filled that role. And that gave Wijnaldum the space. And I think what's great about Wijnaldum's goals is the, again, like I keep repeating this, it's the audacity to believe that you can pull those off.
Yeah.
Because what happened was Trent Alexander-Arnold comes from the right side. He sees that he can't do a cross. He can't do a random cross over the, like an aerial cross.
Yeah.
So because there's not enough bodies, there are too many defenders. So he needs
whips it in.
He whips it in, sees that Wijnaldum is the only player making the run, and then Wijnaldum finishes it off. Excellent finish for that second goal.
Yeah. Even the header, very good header.
And then coming to the header.
You keep calling it Ronaldo-esque. I'm not going to argue with that, even though I slightly do disagree. It wasn't really Ronaldo-esque because it wasn't... Okay, I'm going to be really nitpicky here and don't hate me. It was a good header, but it wasn't Ronaldo-esque primarily because Ronaldo's one of the best headers of the ball in terms of just leaping ability and connection.
He didn't have the height of Ronaldo, but had the delivery of Ronaldo.
I'm not even talking about the height. If you see the replay, it goes off the top or the back of Wijnaldum's head. It's not a clean header. Take nothing away from the header. Still a good header. Which is why I'm saying I'm being very nitpicky.
I can hear the disclaimers.
But Ronaldo-esque, maybe not.
For me, it's Ronaldo-esque because there's a moment it looks like he's paused midair and then he has to duck and then he heads it in. So to me, that was just fantastic and great work from Shaqiri.
See, I'm just saying, like, no matter how much I criticize the header, you're not going to give a fuck because it still went in and that equalized the game.
No. But I think it needs to be, like, the reason why this debate is important, and it's okay if it's not settled, but at least to be like, there are two sides to this, is how much intent are you giving to the player?
Of course, absolutely.
And I think, I would give Gini Wijnaldum complete intent.
Absolutely.
Because like I said, he showed an audacity with the previous shot before.
Absolutely.
Right? And then I think that sort of inspires other players to push, try that one thing more, try that one extra shot. And then Shaqiri puts that insane mental cross.
Yeah.
And he rises above it. And because I think, if you noticed, Origi and they're close by. And Origi doesn't go for it. Because there's some sort of communication that you go for it.
Yeah.
And then he goes for it and he clears it. And what a moment of madness that was. Because I think, even when it was 3-2, it just felt like it was anytime soon, Barcelona are going to have that extra goal. And that's it. And that's done, right? Because you have to put the game to rest with one because it's 5 or whatever.
Yeah.
And then when that third goal came in, and it's 3 minutes of madness. I think it happened in a span of 2 minutes, but he comes in and he just changes the game completely on its head. And look, and that's when I think Liverpool started believing.
Yeah.
Not just the players, but even the fans
in
the stadium, everywhere.
Yeah.
Definitely me. Because
when
I watched the game, it was just like, I'll watch it till the
till the first Barcelona goal. And then I can sleep. Call it a night.
And the way Klopp hyped up the game, right?
Yeah.
It looked like he was done too.
Yeah.
Because prior to the game, in the press conference, he said, there are two things. Either we go all in, or we go out beautifully.
Hmm.
And I think he said go all in because the manager can't say, we're going to lose.
Because
what he wanted to do was go out.
Well, they went through beautifully. It was a nice mixture of both those options for Klopp. Quickly, on to the next player that we need to focus on is Divock Origi, because he got the first and the last goal.
And
I hate to point this out, but I kind of predicted it.
Yes, you did.
Check this out.
Going without Firmino and it's going to be great, guys. We have no attack at Anfield. But
hey, man, Divock Origi. If there ever was a good audition, Newcastle was it.
I mean, but I think that was a big fluke. I think Divock Origi has fluked it twice. As much as I love it, like, I'm not complaining. I love the flukes.
Yeah.
Yeah, Amog, you clearly have a knack for predicting Liverpool.
Also, I'm more passionately supporting Liverpool or just like...
No, you're just optimistic.
No, I'm just giving Liverpool more of the benefit of the doubt than a Liverpool fan. What is happening to me?
No, I think it's also because you hang out with a cautious pessimist of a Liverpool fan.
Yeah.
Or just like someone who doesn't want to jinx things.
Like, no, it's almost like I can't really show this much love to my club currently. So I'm living vicariously. I mean, see, honestly...
And then you'd rather choose Liverpool.
Yeah, no, not at all. I'm just saying, if there's anything United can learn from this the semi-final against Barcelona that Liverpool played, is that you got to work hard, you got to press, and you got to get people who can cross the fucking ball into the box.
I feel like the biggest thing, and we'll get to this later, is that you got to believe that there's a Trent Alexander-Arnold in your youth system. Because to have somebody like that and then to... like. The idea that there's somebody as talented as that.
Yeah, yeah.
Or like you could make a buy like Andy Robertson and then play like the likes of Ashley Young as much as he's a great team guy.
Look, see, that's what. But he's a great team guy, whatever, but it's time to move on.
And who's your left?
Luke Shaw. Really fault Luke Shaw too much. He's had a good season. He made the mistake that gave...
He's a 52 million buy, Amog. And something at that point, he was he's the most expensive English defender.
Yeah, because you guys fucked it up for every other club with Southampton.
We did. Yay!
Alright, so Southampton now just has a fucking premium on every one of their players that a top six club in England.
By the way, Lovren was one of them.
I think every player in Liverpool was one of them
at some point.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think that's, if anything, I feel like that's the lesson for, is that just like you said it before, is that invest in passionate young players who are from there.
Absolutely.
Or just passionate players from around the area who sort of amp it up.
Yeah.
Because I think as much as your Salahs and your Manes, bring that extra skill and commitment to the team, you have the local boys who can do unthinkable stuff.
Absolutely.
Which brings me to... Wait, let's finish up the discussion on Origi before we go to the next
part. I don't know. Origi just scored two goals. That's it. Which brings you to...
No. Origi scores two goals. I don't want to say they're flukes.
Now you don't.
No, and I'll tell you what I'm saying. But I'm saying those two goals that he scored are still extraordinary circumstances.
Because it's Origi. Scoring. Goals.
Origi scored in a match. Extraordinary. Yeah.
A semi-final.
I mean, what's extraordinary is the fact
Champions
that
before... against Barcelona. Many filters to make it special.
Before this match, Wijnaldum had one goal in all Champions League matches. In a span of 3 minutes, he had two.
Yeah.
So, I think that's the extraordinary bit. I mean, I'm just saying the first goal, it should have been Henderson's goal in that he played a bad shot. It was an excellent ball by Sadio Mane who read Jordi Alba's...
Good build-up play.
Because... I think that was very smart thinking, right? Because Jordi Alba is going to head the ball.
Yeah.
And there are two options. Either he heads it successfully or he heads it pathetically.
Yeah.
Which is he did the latter.
Yeah.
And because there's no way there's no point attacking Alba because he's going to get to the ball before you. And then he puts the ball in.
Yeah.
Henderson's making a run in the penalty.
Yeah.
In the penalty box. I'm like, what? And Henderson misses it. That's when you're like, okay, wow. This is believable.
Yeah.
And then Origi scores. I'm like, this is unbelievable again. Yeah. This is madness. And then coming to his second goal, which brings me to the one person I really want to talk about this game, is Trent Alexander-Arnold.
Absolutely.
What a night for him.
Yeah.
What has he done? In 20 years old, two consecutive Champions League finals he's going to be in. In one of them, he controlled Ronaldo.
Yeah.
And now he played in the match where Messi was controlled too.
Yeah.
And 5 years back, he was the ball boy who was handing, who saw Gerrard slip. Stuff of legends.
Are you going to cry? Don't cry.
No, please. Gerrard was in the... for me, I loved that Gerrard was watch the match.
Yeah.
I think nothing made me happier than watching Gerrard watch the match.
And you think he's going to sign Trent for Rangers?
I think Gerrard's going to sign himself back into the team.
Just for the final.
Just for
the final. Let me play.
Let me play 1 minute. But yeah, and I think just what a journey for him to come here in the last 5 years, to come here and
two assists
and something, the audacity that he brings to this team.
Yeah.
Like I said, that first assist to Wijnaldum.
Yeah.
And finally, let's talk about that. I know you want to keep it a short episode, so let's keep it short.
No, that's fine. This corner, we should definitely talk about it. Because something special.
About everything. Yeah, because let's talk about all the build-up that goes into this corner, not just in the game, but from Liverpool's preparation for this game.
Yeah.
So apparently in the first leg, Jurgen Klopp noticed that every time a free kick was given to the opposing team, in this case Liverpool, he noticed that Barcelona players would take some time to recover.
Yeah.
Either because they were moaning, because they were aged, because they're trying to get themselves in a position.
Because they're Barcelona and they can't deal with a refereeing decision being given against them.
So all the ball boys in the Liverpool at Anfield were told, to give the ball back to Liverpool immediately because it buys them those extra 5 seconds. So that was part of the preparation for this game. And which is something that helped Liverpool.
That's excellent.
Because Barcelona definitely tried to slow down the game after the first one.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Which is a smart tactic, which is their tactic.
Yeah.
Because they want to play that passing game or whatever. We'll get into a big, larger debate about the nature of English football later. But anyway.
Shall write a PhD thesis
on this. I can go on this game. Yeah. So they were prepared, which is why, so even though Barcelona slowed the game down, every time there was a ball that went out, every time there was a free kick, Liverpool had those extra 5 seconds to up the pace of the game.
Yeah.
So now that's in the context of the preparations for this game. And coming into this game, right, into that little movement itself. So Trent Alexander-Arnold was going to again, trying to look for an aerial cross in. It was not happening. There were not enough players in good positions. And Jordi Alba, I think, was doing a good job of marking this fellow.
Hmm.
Right? He wasn't reading his moves. I mean, he was reading his moves perfectly. So, and I think it's something, and he did something only a 20-year-old player who's played in the streets can do, which is he played for the corner. Which is not something an old experienced player will do. It's not something a player playing for honor or, you know, these grander schemes like a Messi or a Ronaldo or even a Salah will ever do.
Yeah, yeah.
He played the corner, which is he hit it at his feet, so it just goes out and he got the corner.
Yeah.
Which brings to, that's one part of this kid playing, this kid from the streets playing football. And then coming to the ball being passed to him because the ball boy passed the ball immediately because he had the ball ready.
Mm.
Immediately to Trent Alexander-Arnold and that ball was kicked out. Mm. Which I think, if I'm not wrong, Origi kicked it out. But it could be anybody who kicked out the ball, the second ball that was in. And because they've prepped for this the whole game, Alexander-Arnold noticed that those guys, the referee has blown the whistle.
Mm.
And in fact, to be honest, half the Liverpool players haven't organized themselves too. Because Shaqiri's still walking.
Yeah.
Shaqiri's like doing a slow walk. Yeah. And he's short. So he can't, his steps aren't even that fast. So he's still walking. He's like, I guess I have to take this corner again.
Yeah.
And it looks like, hey, this is going to be a moment that... this is going to be a replay of what happened at Newcastle.
Yeah.
So Barcelona has seen this.
Yeah.
It's Origi and everybody's seeing that. And couldn't script it. That fucking cheeky lad comes back and goes it. And you can see Origi signaling to him saying, dude, play to me. And then he scores it.
Beautiful.
What a game. What a piece of beautiful football that only a young player who played in the streets can think of.
That is the key word of the episode. Audacity.
Audacity.
Also the platform that we edit this podcast on. Audacity.
Oh, yes. I didn't think...
nobody needed to know that, but
Amog.
Sure.
Product placement. Thinking business, even in the greatest times.
Of course.
I guess you learned that from the guys who manage Manchester United. No,
don't kick a man when he's down, Mukesh.
You know who doesn't know that? Suarez. Fucking shoot.
Yeah.
But last thing we have to talk about is... and I swear we landed here. Is Jurgen Klopp. I mean, I know there's no silverware. He has to be a great... I think he's a modern day great. And I'll tell you why this is so important. And I think it's something I mentioned earlier. I don't know if I mentioned the podcast or when we were talking earlier. Is that this way the season's been building up.
Yeah.
Liverpool supporters and players definitely, right? I mean, of course, players and definitely supporters needed a moment of catharsis. Needed something to take back.
Mm.
Right? And it looks like the title is done. Because I don't expect Brighton to... I don't think anybody expects Brighton to accomplish anything against Man City. But I think, and what is the feeling you get when you win a title? Is that sense of relief, some sense that you did it together. You were there when it happened. And I think he gave it. He delivered on this match and nobody saw it coming. It was the greatest, probably the greatest game at Anfield in modern history. And I think Jurgen Klopp is a modern great. I think not, with this match for me, he's become a modern great with or without a trophy.
Do you think he's finally killed off the ghosts of celebrating with the entire team in front of the cop after the 3-3 draw with West Brom?
I don't think there were ghosts. I don't think there was anything to kill. He just said thank you.
Yeah, but there was an elaborate celebration where everybody went up and raised their hands up in the air like you would after you win a fucking trophy. And of course, Liverpool have no idea what that feels like. But
you don't even have an idea what Champions League feels like.
That's okay. We won the Europa League last year. It's fine. Okay. We still have more trophies. Let's not get into that.
But Amog, you don't have the night. You don't have this experience that I've had.
That's fine. We've had enough of those experiences anyway. I'm saying, let's not get into that slanging match. It was a good sight to see. Like,
it's a good sight.
Definitely for a Liverpool fan. But for any fan of football, and I say this as a United fan, for any fan of football, just to see the cop end with their scarves up, with the entire Liverpool squad celebrating and singing You'll Never Walk Alone with them. It's a fucking great sight.
It's a great sight. And the kings and gods of Liverpool over there, I think Fowler was there, Gerrard was there, Daglish was there.
Yeah.
If I'm not wrong, even Luis Garcia was there.
Yeah.
So, and
Luis Garcia, would you... Kings and gods of...
The men.
Yeah.
The men. Everybody was there.
Peasant. Yeah. Kings and gods and peasants.
The peasant. Everybody was there, and I think that was...
Yeah.
It was a great sight to see. And I think for me today, Klopp becomes a great.
Absolutely.
Today's the day. And because Mourinho praised him too. So if you can get Mourinho's approval, I think you're a great.
Yeah. I think Mr. Anthony Martial is still waiting for that.
For that approval?
Yeah.
Oh, by the way, in other news, Chelsea's transfer ban has been upheld.
Yes,
Chelsea, shit.
You couldn't resist yourself.
Couldn't resist, sorry.
But yes, Chelsea's transfer ban has been upheld, and we shall talk about it more in the regular episode that will come out on Tuesday. But before we end the episode, now that Liverpool's through to the finals, predictions for the final.
Okay. My predictions for the finals. I'm very happy to take Ajax or Tottenham. And for me, it's a fantastic victory of... See, for me, if it's Tottenham, it's a fantastic victory of English football.
Yeah.
That idea of power, strength, speed,
yeah,
and everything coming together finally.
Yeah.
And I've told you before that I love Tottenham.
Yeah.
I think Tottenham and Arsenal, I know they're... Whatever. Those are two teams I respect other than Liverpool.
Yeah.
Respect Salvez. So I'm happy taking Tottenham and Ajax for obvious reasons. The young team, playing against money, playing just very much... everything that I want to see at Liverpool, and it's fucking fantastic. So I don't care who comes.
I think it's an Ajax-Liverpool final and Ajax defeat Liverpool.
Yeah, the only reason I think Ajax will defeat Liverpool is...
I know that Tottenham won't be able to. Even though Tottenham on paper are a stronger team.
Okay, let me not jinx it, but okay. If it's Ajax, Liverpool lose. If it's Tottenham, Liverpool win.
I agree completely, yeah.
And the only reason I think Liverpool will lose to Ajax is because... I think Liverpool were good when they're steamrolling. But I think there's a 2 to 3 week break.
Yeah.
And then they'll come in and then those first 20 minutes, they'll zone out. They won't know what hit them.
Mm.
And I think that's when things go off the thing for Liverpool. And then Klopp has a habit of playing this is my biggest criticism of Klopp is that he plays the occasion, not the game.
Mm.
I mean, it's changed obviously now. But again, in finals, in the two finals that he's taken us to, he's done that. Against Sevilla and against... Real Madrid last year.
Yeah.
But hopefully the players have learned. This time we have Alisson.
Yeah. And not Karius.
This time we have...
Big step up.
Yeah, this time we have Fabinho instead of relying on Lallana, who's also great, but again, just a lot more reliable. So,
sure.
Excited for the final. Again, I'm much more excited and confident about this final than I was last year, but again, you know what? As a Liverpool fan, I'm finally happy. I don't care what happens.
Awesome. And on that happy note, it's time to end this episode. If you like the episode, do give us a 5-star rating on any podcasting app that you can get this podcast on. You can follow Prashant on Twitter and Instagram. You can follow Mukesh on Instagram at
Mukesh Manjunath.
And you can follow him on Twitter at
Muktagal, as in #Tagal.
You can follow me on Twitter at Amograndive, on Facebook at Amograndive Comedy, and on Instagram at Amograndive.
Doesn't matter what his name is, guys, because Liverpool won.
See you on Tuesday.